seen anything like that.
Wide right. Little roller up along first. Behind the back. It gets through Buckner. Here comes Knight, and the Mets win it.
It's the Davey Max Sports Program, and here's your host, Dave McDonald.
Well, I thank you very much for that wonderful intro. You sound like you're peaches and cream today, Chris.
Thanks.
It's the Davey Max Sports Program, Eastside Dave McDonald, a.k.a. Davey Mac, with me, Chris Pepper Stanley.
Oh, Pepper.
Thanks.
I guess he would be the announcer guy, right? Because that's what you do, Pepper. You're like the Ed McMahon, I guess.
Yeah, Rod Roddy.
You feel good about that?
He's like Rod Roddy with that coat on.
He is. He's got the razzle-dazzle rainbow coat with the microphones and the equipment and the Pro Tools and the buttons and the this and the this and the Schaefer this week. Schaefer beer. When you're a cheapskate, drink Schaefer. Shawno.
Woo, Shawno.
With the sunglasses and the hat and the beard. And the Wednesday shirt special. That's right. He's wearing his Midwestern Cowboy Country Western Blues special. Roy!
Roy's number one.
Top five best Roys of all time. Let's go. Around the table. I'm saying Roy Scheider. Pepper.
Don't have one.
Shawno.
Roy Harder.
Roy. Roy Rogers. I go back to me. I say Roy Halladay. This is the Davey Mac Sports Program. Philadelphia Phillies ace. And that was the shortest game in the history of competition. Boy, oh boy. You guys had nothing, huh? You just had Roy Rogers. You named the Roy sitting next to you, Roy Harder.
Yeah.
I at least gave you two. I gave you a sports guy because it's the Davey Mac Sports Program. And I went with, what was my first one?
Roy Scheider.
Roy Scheider from Jaws. I'll throw you another sports one out.
He's dead, right?
Roy Jones, boxer, and I'll throw you another Philly, Roy Oswalt. Roy Scheider did die, yeah. Okay, listen, folks, we can talk about that all day. We have to move on. I mean, this is silly. But you want to talk about a Roy, or do you want to talk about a McIlroy?
Oh, hey! Nice.
Rory McIlroy. Northern Irish pepper, so don't applaud him as a countryman. He's the kind that
Proddy.
We're supposed to not like. I'll say that. Yeah. That doesn't mean that we really do. I mean, Pepper does. Pepper doesn't like those people.
Don't
That's
like
what he
him
calls
at
them,
all.
By the way.
Mm-hmm.
Those people,
yeah,
the Northern Irish. But Rory McIlroy, Northern Irish, destroys the U.S. Open. I mean, obliterates Tiger's record, I believe, which was 13 under, don't quote me, no, 12 under. He shoots 16 under. He kills. By the way, first time in since, think about this, in 1909, that there was no American in the top five at the U.S. Open. When something in sports hasn't happened in 102 years, that, my friends, is pretty crazy.
Insane.
Okay, you like that analysis, whatever it is?
I like the analysis.
Okay, I like the analysis. Rory McIlroy, the future of golf. They went so far as to say he is the new Tiger Woods, that watch out, here comes Rory McIlroy.
What?
Well, he won a major.
He won a major.
That's he Tiger. Also almost won the Masters this year. He kind of folded in the fourth round, and had he not made... it's possible, let's face it. You know, I worked at an Irish bar one time. And if you went into the Irish bar, called the Dublin House, Red Bank, New Jersey.
Nice.
And if you went in there and asked for an Irish car bomb,
ooh,
the bartenders would not serve you one. Not only that, but they wouldn't kick you out, but they would
shun
turn
you.
Around. Yeah, they would shun you for a good hour or so until you probably got the point. And if you stuck around for an hour, they'd go back to you and say, now what do you want to drink? Not too gimmicky. They found it offensive. I'm just throwing it out there.
To drink.
Car bomb.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't go into like a Middle Eastern bar and say, give me an airplane into a building you know, cocktail or something. Hey, listen, let's go back. Let's go back to the golf.
What's okay, in that anyway?
So Rory McIlroy, the new Tiger Woods. That's what's on the table. Papa Stanley.
No, never. Oh, not black.
Sean, no.
Yeah, too soon.
Too soon.
Too soon.
The answer is too soon.
Thank you.
We're not going to even address that not black comment.
What?
That was made. This is a friendly sports show that you can hear on iTunes or Stitcher.com. Look, he is young. He's talented. He nearly won the Masters. What I like to fantasize about.
Mm. Go ahead. Mm.
Not in that way.
Oh.
Well, maybe in that way.
Yeah.
Is had he held on and won the Masters, now we're halfway to a Grand Slam, a possible Grand Slam, and he would have headed back. He, you know, the next major is the British Open, and that's his home turf. So now we're talking about a realistic chance for a guy to get a Grand Slam, winning all four majors in a golf calendar year, not the Tiger Slam, okay? Not the Tiger Slam.
You're bad-mouthing Tiger?
Tiger Woods is finished. Rory McIlroy.
Now, I think I said on the show, 10 years he'll come back or some crazy number.
Yeah, that's insane.
I don't think it is.
He can't come back 10 years from now. Because right, he'll be 45.
I'll break it down to 5.
That's fine.
44, something like that. Yeah, that's too old. Even in golf. I know it seems like golfers can play forever.
Yeah, they can.
And some of them can.
Like bowlers.
But I remember Raymond Floyd won, I think, a U.S. Open when he was 50. Nah, I'm probably making that up.
Mm-hmm.
Let's not fact check anything.
The weird thing about Rory McIlroy is sometimes, I don't want this to come off poorly, but sometimes
I don't think it will.
Sometimes certain English and Irish people, like they look exactly the same. Like I could look at him and say, boy, that guy, he has like kind of like big teeth and there's a certain piggish thing about his nose.
They're not attractive or good to look at.
I'm describing them like an 1880s cartoon. Like a cartoon that you would see in Gangs of New York.
Yeah, is this propaganda?
I don't want him here.
They're taking our job.
I'm a native. I don't know. That's just my own little comment. It was great to see. I watched a bunch of it, and this guy was shooting the heck out of the ball. It was amazing. I'm telling you one thing right now. While you Nimrods are watching your Bravo reality television, Davey Mac we are entering a very solid sports era. We've got good baseball. It sounds like they might be making a tiny little bit of progress with the NFL lockout situation.
Yeah, there'll be a season.
I think there will be.
I agree.
We're having some fun new blood with the golf. We got the basketball. We all know about that, how great that is. Wimbledon's just starting right now. I know Pepper's excited.
Oh,
are you watching?
Oh, definitely.
Do you have cable?
No.
I didn't think so. So you're not watching.
Don't
that
have
was
cable
a fabrication.
TV. Yeah, I lie constantly.
Yeah, apparently. Apparently. To the landlord, to everybody.
Yeah.
Why to Davey Mac, though? This is your one place
you're
to be honest.
You're just another person to me.
All right. That's fair. Even if you are our Rod Roddy.
Ouch.
He's dead, too.
Wimbledon, he did die. You know how I know that? Because Price is Right then had open auditions to... take the Rod Roddy position.
And did you go?
No, I made a Twitio, though, of it.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Did you wear a jacket?
It's actually on East Side Dave Country if you see the video gallery.
Yeah.
EastsideDaveCountry.com. Why don't you see if you can pull that up, Peppy Hamburger? Because this was a serious attempt on my way to driving to the liquor store after I had gone to Dunkin' Donuts at 10 in the morning.
Sure.
That's good.
There's nothing better than picking up a bagel and some Jack Daniels.
Yeah.
Sean Hill's laughing.
Yeah, that's what I had today.
So that's how I knew, because they said, you know, send us your videos or something if you want to try out for the Rod Roddy spot.
Whoa, that's
so I
good.
Made a very cheaply awful Twitio of it and emailed it to CBS. Didn't hear back!
Weird.
Surprisingly.
Yeah.
Rory McIlroy on fire. Is he going to beat Tiger Woods? You know it. And what he's not going to do is he's not going to marry some Swedish model and then go insane with the Perkinson's waitresses already.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we're not even talking about classy restaurants with that whole scenario. We're talking about Perkins. Insane. Perkins. My grandmother used to go to Perkins. God bless her soul.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what I'm saying. Here's Tiger. You should probably, you know, the Marriott or something.
Denny's.
I don't know, Roy. You're a classy guy. What's a nice stand-up hotel? Four Seasons? Is that something?
Sofitel?
Sofitel?
It's a French chain.
Okay.
It's where they had the...
go there.
The lady got abducted.
Go there. What about duck?
Wait, what?
The lady got abducted. Well, I'm glad you're here.
He's the only one that knows that, too. That's what
I thought Roy said. It's where the lady ordered the duck.
Oh, the diplomat. You know, the one, the French diplomat?
Yeah, I believe that was Frantic, starring Harrison Ford. You're giving up. You're getting the plot of Frantic. Where's The Price is Right? It's there.
I don't see it.
It is. Just keep looking. Oh, boy. So we got the Wimbledon. Now, Wimbledon's on ESPN2. And I'm a little bit surprised about that.
Because
that, to me, feels a little second class.
I agree.
Not only that, but, you know, this is Wimbledon. This is, and, you know, with all due respect to the U.S. Open in America, come on, let's face it. Wimbledon's the number one tournament for tennis. You're talking about the prime time, baby. You're talking about the big tournament that we all love. If you look at it, you can look it up on my YouTube. It'll definitely be there. Price is Right. And I'm surprised. I'm surprised that it gets elbowed to ESPN2 for college baseball World Series.
Really?
That's surprising to me.
ESPN2 is for like soccer and bowling.
You know, I figured that.
I know.
You had to throw
I'm
in
just
bowling.
Saying.
Had to throw in
it's
bowling.
Always where I find
really
it.
Like bowling.
You had to do it. you would think they would reverse that. Wimbledon should be on ESPN. College World Series should be on ESPN2, which brings me to yet another Davey Mac talking point. Sorry, I was waiting for some lasers or something. Okay, we don't have any production for that. College World Series. Everybody loves college baseball. College basketball, March Madness. Everybody loves college football. Yet, no love for the College World Series. I mean, someone's watching, but it's not nearly as big as March Madness.
Oh, no one cares about college baseball.
Well, this
no
is my point. This is my point. Why? Because I'll throw in just before you say, well, it's not the pros. Well,
no.
College basketball's not the pros. College football's not the pros. Also,
college basketball is a tournament.
Okay, let me say this. Well, so is College World Series. It's a double elimination tournament.
I think people, it might be too slow. I don't know why. It's basically the same speed as regular baseball.
Yeah.
Professional baseball, but people just don't
and
care about these college
and
players.
Professional baseball, like the Major League Baseball World Series. Now, probably not this year. I would possibly guesstimate that the NBA Finals will get better ratings than the 2011 World Series. That'll be a guess, though. But usually, the Major League Baseball World Series gets better ratings than the NBA Finals. So baseball is still, you know, it's ratings-wise the second most popular sport. So you would think, okay, people like the Major League Baseball World Series. They watch it, and they watch it more than they watch NBA Finals. Yet when it comes to college, they're watching basketball more than the College World Series, which if you watch some games, it has its drama. I'll go even further.
Whoa.
I am guilty of this sometimes. I try and tune into the College World Series, but I'll tell you something that I watch every single game. It might sound insane, but I do. Because, again, Pepper brings up the tournament. Little League World Series.
Mm-hmm.
I bet you Little League World Series gets even better ratings.
Oh, without a doubt.
Than the College World Series. You say without a doubt.
I don't know why, if you're about to ask me why. Because just people want to see little kids play baseball. They want to see professionals play baseball. They don't want to see college kids play baseball.
That's so bizarre.
They just want to see little kids do like amazing adult things. Anytime you get a little kid even playing the piano well or doing any
true.
Of that stuff, you just like
whenever they're little, they're like little prodigies. And
yeah, exactly.
Right. Whole futures ahead of them.
Did you found the Price is Right video?
It took way too long to find, but yeah.
Okay. So Rod Roddy died. CBS said, give us your tapes or videos. There was what they called an open audition, and I never heard back. Here was my audition video. By the way, I'm filming this while I'm driving.
To the liquor store.
Well, I just heard the Price is Right announcer is leaving, and they're taking on air audition tapes. So, Here's my audition. Kathy Moriarty of New York City, come on down!
The face makes it.
But here you go.
I hope I pass.
Right there. Okay. So, go ahead.
Was that a bar and a liquor store?
Listen, you don't need to. Yes. Great.
What, was it together?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Right. Oh, yeah. Wow. Together. Oh, you'll really? Have those in Astoria?
No.
They're great because as a result, they stay open till.
You can start drinking and then still, when you want to go home, buy some booze, leave.
Well, you could get like, you know, a 12-pack of beer at 1:30 in the morning because the bar's still open. Can't buy hard liquor after midnight, though. That's a New Jersey rule.
Just got to have it in your house already.
Okay, please, Sean.
Just saying.
Please.
Be prepared.
Please, Mr. Schaefer. I'm going to call you Paul Schaefer from that one.
Sure, makes sense. I look just like him.
So in the end, this is what we have to say about College World Series. Get lost. Apparently, no one cares about you. I'm going to try and care this year. I don't know why.
You're going to tap out.
Well, I am interested more in Wimbledon than the College World Series. Yeah. I have to admit. Speaking of that, Serena Williams... She goes out, you know, and she's battled some injuries. She's been on the sidelines. She had that, it was like a blood clot that almost killed her.
Yeah.
Okay. She's back at Wimbledon, the place of her greatest success, if you will, her greatest triumphs. Her and her sister, in fact, loved Wimbledon. So she goes out, she plays the first round. You know, first round, Serena Williams. I don't care if she had 7 blood clots and was hemorrhaging while the match was going on. She's not going to lose a first round matchup. And she, of course, wins her first round matchup. And then the post-match conference or press conference, this is what happened as they asked her how she felt.
Well, Serena, we could see out on court and we can see here what this win means to you, an emotional day after all you've been through recently.
Yeah, it's been, I usually don't cry, so I don't understand it, but it's just been so hard, and I never dreamt I would be here right now, you know, so.
Sounds like Shano.
And to win, like, I just wanted after to win at least more one Schaefer's. Match here, and seeing I'm not playing
doubles.
This
is what doubles, he sounds like.
You know, I just thought it would be, you know, it was a really big win for
so?
Me.
So?
People all around the world are watching this now, and for those people who
this
don't
guy be
know,
any more British?
Coming into Wimbledon, you
all
were
there at Wimbledon,
in your own words.
We get it.
On
you're
your
British
at one point in the past year.
Enough of the accent.
This is it's so fake,
so
though.
And,
as soon as they go home, you know, and the cameras are off them, they're like, "Hey, how are you?"
Year, I don't you think.
And then the cameras turn on. They're like, "Hey, you know, wait, were you? What's the matter? Why are you crying? Why are you crying, Serena?"
Pretty awesome. And you know, I didn't expect to play. All
right, that's enough. My point was this. First round matchup and she's crying. Again, you know, even if she came back from a coma, pull it together, sweetheart. I mean, this is a tournament that you own.
That's
don't
over.
Show people that you're so vulnerable for crying out loud. If I saw her crying like that, forget it. I'd attack her. I'd make her run all over the court. Hopefully kill her during the match.
You want to murder her?
If I was her opponent, I'm saying.
That'd be sweet.
Serena, how do you feel about your match? Is your name out of court crying? Are you tennis ball and saying hey hey?
Those aren't words.
What about Shababy Hey Who?
Okay.
Pepper.
Yes.
If I give you $12.
All right, I'm in.
Will you buy cable just for the month of, you know, for the next 2 weeks? And this way you can watch it?
I'm going to need like 50.
Because. You were supposed to be the tennis master.
What was this?
I'm the overall sports master. You claimed you like tennis.
Yeah, I like tennis. I'm
he loves
tennis
it.
Well, how can you like tennis and not watch Wimbledon, for crying out loud?
I don't have I don't watch television at all.
What?
I have basic TV package.
I love TV so much. The pictures move.
They sure do, Dave.
The pictures are moving. I can't believe it. Mom, Da, come in here. The pictures are moving!
Is this still the interviewer?
I don't know what it is. All right, so hold on.
Yeah.
So if I give you $12, you won't... And
if you give
and
me
I don't mean you drink that money away, big guy. Glug, yeah. Glug, glug.
Yeah, then it's going to a tall, six-pack of tall boys.
you won't get cable because all you need is ESPN2.
$12
ain't
going to get me a cable.
$12 will get you basic cable, and that will come with ESPN, ESPN 2, right?
No, it's like 50, 60 bucks.
Oh, no,
basic.
It's not.
Yeah,
it is. You have any idea what things cost?
Nope. My wife handles the finances.
Smart.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I still think it's $3.50 for a pack of cigarettes. What am I supposed to know? Listen. So if I give you $50, I think this is a grift now. Because the last
How am I grifting?
Because when I was in Astoria, Queens.
Yeah.
And what a wonderful A-town. Time that was, 2007.
I visited you there once.
Yeah.
I visited your apartment. It looked like a
Well, the floor had dirt. It was It was a basement apartment.
It looked like a pawn shop, your apartment. There was just crap, old things just laying around everywhere. And there was a lot of it, too. I don't know how you fit it all in.
That was good crap.
It was all behind bulletproof glass.
Let me tell you something. Well, I did have bars on my windows.
Yeah, I know.
As if someone would want to break into my little awful cave of an apartment.
I should have
broken. You should have. I would have shot you with my BB gun.
Ooh.
Handgun, that is. One time I sent one of the interns. Who was that one that we all hated?
There's a lot. It's really a lot. That's a long list.
Like, he always wore that rugby shirt. What was that kid's name?
Dumplings?
No. It was, no. That wasn't, he was an XM. He's definitely an XM kid. And he kind of talked like this.
Vertigo?
He was like, yes! It was Vertigo. It was Vertigo. Yeah, he always wore the rugby shirts and he talked like this. And he was always, you couldn't tell if he was being sarcastic or not.
Oh, wow.
Like, because like, he always had a sarcastic tone to his voice. So you'd be like, that was a hell of a basketball game last night.
Yeah, it was really great.
You're like, is that sarcasm or?
Did you watch
what
it?
What are you doing? Yeah.
Yeah.
No, it's a really great game. I'm agreeing with you.
Wait, okay, are you really agreeing with me? What is going on? So I sent him because I'd forgotten something, like my keys or my wallet. I sent him to my apartment, and they called the cops on him.
Dave, they actually called the cops on me.
Did they call the cops, sir?
Yeah.
What's going on? Your landlady's a real piece of work. Stop it! I hated that kid. I hope he's listening right now. He asked for a letter of recommendation.
Did you give one?
I said, sure, this kid sucks.
It's not a very good one.
Listen, what do we got with this Jack McKeon here? I mean, this guy's 80 years old. The Florida Marlins just decide out of the blue. Well, not out of the blue. Their manager, Edwin Rodriguez, resigns after having one win in the month of June.
Oh, man.
Talk about a cold streak. He was, I believe, 1-17 were the Florida franchise. Marlins in the month of June.
Yeah.
You know what? The funny thing is that franchise is always in shambles. They've won two championships since 1997.
Yeah.
Ask Mets fans how many championships they've won since 1997.
Zero.
Focus!
All right.
Ask Mets fans how many championships they've won, period. Two.
Yeah.
They are tied with the Florida Marlins in championships. But they went out. They got the guy who won. He was a manager in 2003. He was 72 years young when he won in 2003. And so they asked him, will you come back and manage again? He's 80 years old. 80.
One more time. Come on.
Talk about not being able to let go of something.
Hey, whatever. What else is he doing? He's 80 years old.
Yeah.
Sure, I'll manage a baseball team. All right.
Now, this is either a wonderful story about how, to quote the great Ricky Lake, age is just a number. Or this is an indictment of how easy a job managing is. That basically you have two moves, basically in the eighth inning. You know, get the lefty up, get the righty up. It's something.
He probably has dementia. I mean, he can still function, though.
It really does go to show you, though. And I love baseball. But you know what? Maybe we do give managers a little too much credit and also a little too much grief when the team's losing. Because if you're getting an 80-year-old on the bench, I'm sorry, 80 years old. Yeah, 80!
80 years old.
80 years old!
I'm going to catch him playing dominoes in the dugout.
Can you imagine?
He was alive during the Depression. What's the big deal?
He was born in 1931.
Yeah.
80. Now, you could not have an 80-year-old on the basketball court. He might have served in Korea.
He probably did.
He probably was there. Yeah, I mean, that goes to show, you know, I mean, he's basically almost Yogi's age. Yogi's probably a little bit older, but holy mackerel.
You should get Yogi managed.
Yogi would sign up for that.
I know.
Yogi was a decent manager, by the way. Yogi got the Yankees to the World Series, got the Mets to the World Series too. Didn't win though. Never won. Mm. He got to the Mets to the 73 World Series. You want to call me the sports master, you can go right ahead.
Oh, okay.
No, I'm not going to do it this time. Are you the sports master?
Oh, yeah. Yes, sir. We need some lasers for that. That's what we need the lasers for. So I just think I don't know. It doesn't seem that an 80-year-old is going to do much good. As soon as he gets there, by the way, he benches their star shortstop, Hanley Ramirez. I love that. Just spanks him like a grandfather. Just, sit out. And everyone, you know, was asking him what was wrong. He just didn't like his attitude. I love that.
That's great.
Furthermore, one of his players, Jack McKeon, 80-year-old manager, asks one of his players, what are you going to do tonight? You know, they had a night off or something like that. Or just finished with a day game. The player goes, you know, I'm just going to, you know, go home and play with Twitter. And he says, oh, what kind of dog is it? He thought Twitter was the player's dog.
That's adorable.
This is your manager, Florida Marlins. Get that franchise out of Florida. Honestly, no one goes to the games and no one goes to Tampa. I don't know why baseball ever put any teams in Florida. I really don't. No one wants to be in the heat.
Why is anything in Florida?
Now, if you had to move a team from Florida, what two cities would you choose?
I'm waiting. I would put it in North Dakota. Not sure what city.
North Dakota.
Yeah. San Francisco.
Okay, they have a team.
Oh, yeah.
You're going to double up on San Francisco?
Why not? New York's got two.
No, yeah, but it's not a big enough market. I mean, if you're going to double up, you might as well go, you know, maybe try and... You know, Philly used to have two. Boston, of course, had two teams with the Boston Braves. You know, what I'm thinking is, I'm sick of the West Coast. I'm thinking you don't want to go there. Why not choose like a nice southern, a town in Louisiana or something? You know, LSU, speaking of College World Series, LSU has a great college program. They're in, you know, the semifinals at the College World Series, it seems, every year. Why not put it near there?
New Orleans.
Okay.
But Fargo, North Dakota.
Fargo? What's sure. You could go to Fargo. And then you have two teams in Minnesota or near, you know, in the same area.
That's fine. What's wrong with that?
It's one too many. Mm-hmm. You could choose Las Vegas, but they Why? Wouldn't like the That's betting insane. Thing, the gambling thing. Pete Rose would love it. Pete Rose would be right at home.
It's too soon.
When I went to Las Vegas for my honeymoon, we were in a casino. And as I'm just walking in one of the casinos, roped off like an animal was Pete Rose, where he was just roped off, and you could go up and stare at him and then move on your way. Like he was a polar bear at the Bronx Zoo. It was the weirdest thing I've ever seen in my life. He's just sitting there. I thought at first it was like a statue. Then I saw him like scratch himself a little bit.
Same haircut?
Same haircut. Mm. And just sitting there. And I think I said something like... baseball screwing you, man.
Good one.
I didn't have much to say.
Did you react?
I did call him Hit King, though. Nice. I go, see you later, Hit King. Yeah.
How many hits?
He was grumpy. Well over 4,000. Yeah. Well over 4,000. Well over 4,000. So there you go. Listen, folks, we're just getting warmed up here. Okay, we have some Joe Buck audio that is going to make you upset because he just doesn't care about baseball anymore. In addition to that, Pat Riley speaking, Tiki Barber has to have some kind of story on HBO Real Sports we'll get to, a little bit of NBA talk, trade and draft talk, Roger Clemens, oh my gosh, so much! Eastside Dave McDonald, a.k.a. Davey Mack here, Chris Pepper Stanley,
hey,
and the Sean O.
The Sean O.
And the Roy, okay? So what you're going to do... is you're going to keep it right here. We pretend to go to a commercial, but there's no commercial. Just keep it here. Let it roll. We're just going to go out and have some cigarettes.
Schaefer.
I don't wanna be free. I was cast in a hell by a jealous god. Devil walked up and said, you don't need no lightning rod. Hardly ever rains down here, I can't recall the last storm. You ain't gonna need that leather jacket, it gets kinda warm. There's one way in, there's no way out. Looks like you're here to stay. All the place is a mess, it's overcrowded. More coming in every day. I said, oh man, wait a minute. There's
yes, sir, Davey Mac Sports Program, Eastside Dave McDonald, a.k.a. Davey Mac. We're back with you. If you're saying, Davey Mac, what are you playing? What are you rocking out to now, Davey Mac? You always have such a fun taste in the rock and the roll.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this is none other than Roy Harter and the Sean 05, the new band from the Davey Mac Sports Program. The engineer, Sean O, the behind-the-scenes cameraman, all-around tech person, Roy. This is their song. What I was upset about was no Davey Mac for a tambourine spot, something like that.
It's not too late.
You can't throw Davey Mac a bone? Include me? You know I do play in the band called The Cuertos.
We'll get you in there, don't worry.
Okay. And yes, Sean O, I will be in the video.
Sweet.
I want to be like, remember when Gene R did that cover of Since I Don't Love You?
Of course, he doesn't. Remember that?
Gary Oldman was the devil?
Yeah.
I want to do the same thing.
Ah, the devil.
Yes.
I got you.
I want to do the exact same. I just want to rip off Gary Oldman from that video.
Sure.
Be a devil, drive a car into a lake, do it with Slash, do the whole thing, okay?
We can get Slash up here.
Okay. Now it is the Davey Mac Sports Program, and we are back, and we are better than ever, and only one quarter of us suffers from vertigo, apparently. Just developed at the tender age of 33 years old. We're standing outside, and I thought, boy, what if this balcony just falls to the ground? We are dead. Never really thought like that before. It's odd that I've never been afraid of heights until literally that moment. I had to come back in and say goodbye. Goodbye, gentlemen.
Yeah, you got pretty freaked out. It was weird.
Because I thought, why wouldn't it crumble one day? I mean, nothing lasts forever. Architecture?
Yeah.
You tell that to the people who built the Brooklyn Bridge.
The pyramids.
Okay? Tell that to the people who built the pyramids. Tell that to the people who built the Grand Canyon. Yeah. Tell it to people who did the other things. Okay?
Sure.
Just think about it.
Those things are pretty sound.
No, they're not.
I don't think anyone built the canyon.
Someone listen.
Must have.
You've heard me. Yeah. God.
Whoa.
God built it. You atheist. Now listen.
I'm like erosion.
Listen to me, folks. I've told you about this Joe Buck. I keep telling it to you over and over and over again. Okay? I am telling you, Joe Buck no longer likes the sport of baseball. In fact, dare I say, he hates it.
Wow.
He's only into football. When you listen to the NFL broadcasts, that's the only time his voice has any juice in him anymore. That's it. You hear him on the Saturday day game. He sounds like he wants to stab poor Tim McCarver for crying out loud.
Come on.
Tim McCarver can't say a word without Joe Buck jumping down his throat. Okay? And then you have Joe Buck, and his voice literally sounds different. So we have some audio here. This is Yankees-Cubs. Yankees are up 4-2 in the game. And no men on. Mariano's in the game. Gives up a solo home run that would make it 4-2.
A 3.
4-3, that's right, with a nice, fun little accent.
Thank you.
Given to us by the Sean O. So that's what the score should be. But let's take a listen to Joe Buck's call, if you will.
That's well hit in the left. And target it. Nate Johnson is tying it. Now a 4-3 game, I beg your pardon. A 2-run game, now a 1-run game. It's 4-3 here in the ninth.
He says it twice, too. He said it twice.
Yeah. Didn't even acknowledge his mistake.
And seriously, we'll take another listen just for the screw up part. Listen to his voice. I mean, what happened to Joe Buck? The same guy who's able to deliver with power, you know, what Randy Moss did is despicable. He doesn't sound like himself anymore.
He's dead inside.
He really is. Let's listen. Let's do it again.
That's well hit in the left. And target. Ray Johnson is tied it. Round of 4-3 game. I think
okay, there you go. That's all. Yep. So the other thing about that is that he so badly wants the Yankees to lose every game that he calls, that he broadcasts.
Can't stand that.
He's such a Midwesterner that he cannot take any East Coast. I'm not even talking about the I'm talking about the East Coast in general.
Yeah.
He would not mind if the Yankees and Red Sox and Phillies all just died in three strange Twilight Zone-ish plane crashes all at the same time.
Disband the franchises, basically.
Disband them, and everyone move to St. Louis. Joe Buck wants the St. Louis Browns back.
Who doesn't?
The worst team in the history of sports. So someone needs to tell Joe Buck, you know what, Joe? Honestly, it just hang up your baseball shoes. You like doing football more. Big deal. Big deal, man. Okay?
Thanks for letting me know.
honestly, and Tim McCarver just sits there like a battered child. Like, you know, Tim McCarver is just frightened because I'm telling you, Joe Buck, Tim McCarver says one word and Joe Buck just he shuts up because Joe Buck is always doing some sarcastic insult at poor Tim McCarver at his expense.
He's like a beaten wife.
He really is. He almost seems like he's like trapped there, like he's Arnold in the back of the bicycle shop in that one Different Strokes episode where he and Dudley almost got, you know, let's just say Pulp Fiction almost got medievaled on there. You know what?
Never saw it.
You never saw that episode?
Come on.
You're too busy getting drunk when you were six. That was the problem.
Possibly.
You started early.
Now the world's all new.
Yeah, I was probably getting liquored up at six.
You never saw
it? I think that was it.
You never saw Different Strokes?
I can't remember. Which one was Different Strokes?
Arnold
Which
Drummond?
One was Different Strokes?
What's she talking about?
Gary
Willis?
Coleman.
Oh, was that with the old white man, right?
Yeah, the guy actually was Mr. Carlson from WKRP in Cincinnati. Oh,
okay. Conrad.
All right, Conrad.
Yeah.
Oh, that's Conrad.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yeah. Conrad Bain was the father.
I get it mixed up with Belvedere.
Way different.
Yeah.
Belvedere?
They were on at the same time, right?
Sometimes.
No, Belvedere was on a little bit afterwards.
No, I mean same era. I mean, same.
No. Belvedere was on afterwards.
Wait, seriously?
Am I not speaking out loud?
I thought maybe you're throwing, like, you know, the time slot.
No. Belvedere was on a little bit afterwards.
Were those primetime TV shows?
Of course they were primetime.
Really?
They had a. And then they went so far as to make Webster as well.
You guys on spinoff?
Well, no, like a poor man's Different Strokes. That's where Emmanuel Lewis came in.
Mixed up with the Webster, too.
Yeah. I just love that Secret Passage.
And Webster?
Secret Passage, what?
I hated Webster. I sniffed it out for the cheapskate ripoff that it was.
It was.
I knew instantly. And, you know, originally they told ex-football player, so just before people say, what the hell does this have to do with sports? It was a long way to go. Alex Karras, former Detroit Lion, was the dad in Webster. They told him originally it'll be a show about a white, you know, couple, and they're going to adopt a child, an African American child. It'll be a nice, like, you know, modern day interracial family and stuff like that. And then instantly they made all they originally told him it was going to be about the parents. They made 100% about Webster, lied to him, and away we go.
Come on,
I know the guy was a lion for years. You should feel sorry for him just because of that.
Yeah.
So there you go. Tim McCarver, I mean, Joe Buck, please. You don't like it anymore.
Give up.
That father of his, you know, this guy had some of the best calls of all time. He had the great Kirk Gibson call with the, you know, I can't believe what I just saw in the 1988 World Series. And Jack Buck is saying, Joey, what happened, little Joe?
That's what he's saying to him?
He's saying from heaven, what happened, Joey? He's crying right now.
Oh.
And the rain outside?
Yeah.
Those are Jack Buck's tears, my friend.
Oh, wow.
Because he's saying, my little boy has grown up to hate the sport that I beloved.
You must become gigantic in heaven.
Oh, yeah. Your eyes are as big as Jupiter.
Whoa.
Damn.
Yeah, you grow quite a bit. It's a big universe, Pepper.
It's disgusting.
Right. Look that up, Peppy Hamburger.
Wait, what? Look what up?
I don't know. Now, we're going to, speaking of baseball, did you hear this about the new playoff system? Have you heard about this?
No, I've not.
Okay. Listen to this.
All right, let's hear it.
No more, possibly, no more divisions.
Okay.
They're going to move. They want to move the Houston Astros. There's 30 teams in baseball, 16 yeah. in the National League, 14 in the American League. You need that to happen. You need to have even amount of teams in each league
yeah. mm-hmm.
so that a team is playing every single night against another team from that league.
Sure.
When they want to move the Astros over the American League, so that would be 15 teams and 15 teams, what that would happen then is you would have to have interleague games every night. There'd be an interleague what? Game.
No.
The schedule would break down to you'd have over 80 games within your league, American or National, and then 70 interleague games a year.
Doesn't make wow. any sense.
That's number one.
It's right. almost half.
No divisions. Top five teams in each league make the playoffs.
Oh, wow.
Teams 4 and 5 play each other. First three teams, you know, they're all in their own thing. Teams 4 and 5 bye, whatever you want to call it. Or if you want to say 4 and 5 get to play in, where they, you know, it might be a 2 out of 3 series, and that's the way it would work. This is ridiculous. This is not the Premier League. We are not sophisticated enough in this kind. I'm not. I won't even speak for the rest of America. I'm not sophisticated to have to do the math, have to say five teams, there's playing, there's interleague games all the time, there's this, there's that. You know, they rolled the dice with having breaking the leagues up into three divisions each and then having a wild card, because a lot of baseball purists, including Bob Costas, were saying wild card in baseball. There was a time where that sounded ridiculous. Wild card sounded strictly like a football term. Now we're looking back on it, and guess what? The wild card worked. It really did. It worked.
Yeah.
And it was fair. You're going to something so ridiculously foreign where there's no league. There's no divisions anymore. So now you don't even have a great, you know, this is the American League East, the Yankees, the Red Sox, the Rays.
Never happened. What are they going to call them?
Well, the problem is they keep leaking this out, leaking it out. And what people feel is that it's not, they're leaking it out to get the media to talk about it. So basically, in other words, bracing people
yeah.
for it. And people feel like it's already done. But they're saying, well, it's a possibility, it's a possibility. So that people have been talking about it. Fans are now hearing about this idea. And when they spring it on fans, you know, baseball fans' heads don't just automatically explode spontaneously.
What's happening?
Because it sounds crazy.
It is crazy. It doesn't sound it. It is.
Doesn't sound like baseball. It honestly sounds like European soccer.
What's the benefit of?
Well, they want another playoff team. My opinion is this. Then if you must have another playoff team, and I think the playoffs are fine now, but if you absolutely must, you want to throw another, have a second wild card, and do what you're going to do anyway. Have the two wild cards play each other.
Mm-hmm.
2 out of 3 series. That's it. Done and done. If you want that fifth team, just do it. This, and I'm sorry, but the biggest thing that I find just ridiculous is the 70 interleague games a year. Goodbye, any specialness of the World Series, and
yeah,
that's even
gone.
Broken down a little bit because of interleague play. But, you know, you still feel like, you know, the Yankees still don't play the Phillies a ton of times, you know?
They shouldn't.
And to have, I'm for way less interleague play in general. I'm for what I would call geographical rivalries, right? And those that cities that don't have them, those areas that don't have them, you kind of force it. In other words, you know, maybe Kansas. I don't know who the Kansas City Royals rivalry would be. I guess it would probably be the Cardinals, right, wouldn't it? St. Louis, Missouri, Kansas City is in Missouri.
Like they're right there.
So I would say those would be the rivalry. But even like, okay, say that's not a big rivalry and it isn't. You know, after you force it, you say you're going to be the rivals. And then, you know, 10, 15 years, guess what? There
done.
Will be a rivalry.
Done, yeah.
Yankees, Mets, you have them play, you know, once in June and once in July.
Yeah,
boom.
Do
maybe
it now.
Even do it around July 4th. You have a special rivalry weekend, and that's what you do. That's how you do it. And get rid of, do people care if the Blue Jays are playing the Pirates? Does it make sense at all? And now you're going to have more? I mean, this is baseball time and time again shows, they don't know how to reach out to the modern day sports fan. They think that they're going to, you know, do things to help the game and everything, and they never know what to do. Remember a couple years ago during the World Series and playoffs where to get younger fans in, they had Mr. Baseball, a cartoon baseball, during the World Series talk to us and give us little tutorials about what a sacrifice bunt was. And it was like, hey, kids, a sacrifice bunt is where you take the bat and try to advance the runner. You're like, what the hell is this? And this was their idea of trying to get like, yeah, we're going to reach out. We're going to have a little cartoon baseball. You know, some old white guy with a cigar came up with that idea. It made no sense.
Kids then, like cartoons.
Kids love those cartoons, see? And the sport is baseball. What if our cartoon is a talking baseball?
Brilliant.
Hey, kids, a fly ball's when the guy was with what? So I thought to myself, I can't have it anymore. I can't have it. And then sometimes Fox brings out the like robot.
Oh, the robot's the best. What are you talking about? Yeah, Why? Doing acrobatics in the corner
Yeah, I know. I hate it.
Just pointing things out for us.
And that robot's just that robot. Whoops! Someone's calling me.
Oh, your phone. Who is it?
That
robot.
Who is it? Who is it?
It's my wife.
Oh,
okay. That robot belongs in football too.
Yeah, that football.
Yeah, hell yeah.
You know,
jumping up and down in the corner of the screen.
Yeah, he does the thing. Yeah. Sometimes he's even wearing the shoulder pads. Mm-hmm. And stuff.
He's always wearing the shoulder pads.
But when it's baseball time, I feel like that robot, you know, does not. It just doesn't.
I think he is good for all sports.
It doesn't fit.
Can't wait to see him in tennis. Wimbledon.
There's the tennis playing robot. Hello. He's wearing all white. What's with those English people in the wearing all white?
It's classy.
We have to follow their rules.
Yeah.
I just feel that. I hate that superiority thing. All white. It's white. Just the way we like all people, see?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
That's a more of a bummy English accent. The guy talks like that's not a woman.
Hey! That's the guy who got beat to death at Clockwork Orange. Spare some cut on me, brother! Oh, and what's so stinking about it? I don't dig that whole white thing.
What?
That's why when it comes, I mean, you know, the Wimbledon thing. That's why when it comes to U.S. Open, I like it. Andre Agassi used to wear the Grion Neen. Grion Neen.
Yeah, Grion Neen.
Thank you.
Hello.
Dyslexia. The talking baseball comes out. Dyslexia is where you jumble up your words. Tiki Barber. This guy's a piece of work. I don't need to read another thing about him. I don't need to see another news magazine, another thing on SportsCenter, on this, on that, on HBO Real Sports already. I got to read this Sports Illustrated article where, because he had a self-inflicted thing where he was hiding away from the media, right?
Yeah.
He compared himself to Anne Frank.
Makes perfect sense.
Whoa.
A multimillionaire.
He's been prosecuted.
Persecuted. Banged an intern while his wife was pregnant.
With twins.
Stays away from the media like a coward. Compares that to hiding away from Nazis. Yeah. Someone needs to go back to Virginia University and take some European history classes. That's what me thinks. Holy mackerel. And then HBO has to do this thing with Tiki where he's saying, you know, I'm depressed and I was depressed and now I need football to snap out of my depression. No, it was football and the 22-year-old blonde girl are the only things that lifts Tiki out of his depression.
That's it. There's those two things.
Tiki is so much about Tiki. I mean, you want to talk about Tiki is the football version of Barry Bonds at this point for me. I mean, these guys just love themselves. They smile all the time. They don't care about anybody. And they just keep on talking.
And they're juiced out of their brains.
Well, I can't say if that's the case.
Allegedly.
Definitely. Okay, I'm not going to go there.
You swayed me, Pepper.
I'm not going to go there, okay? He said, Tiki Barber said, he needs football more than football needs him. Yeah.
Obviously. I guess we can agree on that.
Really? Are you serious? Because I thought the NFL was just going to fold up after Tiki retired in 2006. So that's it. Cancel the Super Bowl.
They're on strike now.
No Tiki. They're locked out.
I'm just saying.
There's a difference.
Whatever.
Not to us.
Yeah.
And Lil Ronde Barber's been nothing but a good citizen. He just sits there.
Keeps his mouth shut.
Playing in the backfield, the defensive backfield in Tampa Bay. Gets some interceptions. Just does the right deal. Do the right thing.
Looks just like Tiki, too. It's great.
I'm just going to ignore that. A little comment.
Oh, Sean.
Question.
Right, come on.
Stealing signs in baseball. Fair? Unfair?
Love it. It's old school. Can't get enough of it.
Yeah, gotta get the signs.
Well, Yorvit Torrealba of the Texas Rangers, he's the catcher, Torrealba, he accused Andrew Jones of the Yankees of stealing signs and relaying them to the batter while at second base.
Good.
Isn't that what you're supposed to do?
I would say yes and yes. First of all, Torrealba has an annoying name.
I'll give you that. Like Tori. It's a girl.
It's like a combination of Joe Torre and Jessica Alba, babe. It's like if Joe Torre and Jessica Alba had a daughter or a catcher. I forgot what sex this catcher for the Texas Rangers is, dude. His name would be Torrealba. It's like, what am I, the actress in Sin City or the ex-manager for the New York Yankees, babe? My name is Torrealba. Thank you. Listen, Torrealba, shut your trap.
hope he's listening.
He is. Actually, what people don't know is Torrealba and all of the Texas Rangers subscribe to the Davey Mac Sports program on iTunes or Stitcher.
Sportsmaster.
They do. They do. And you know what I'm just going to say? Because I know that. Josh Hamilton, keep that nose clean. Okay.
I don't think that's going to happen.
San Antonio Spurs, right?
They're the basketball team.
Three possibly future Hall of Fame. Well, Tim Duncan is a shoo-in for the Hall of Fame. Manu Ginobili, I would say he could make the Hall of Fame. He's sort of on the borderline. Classic player. I would throw him in there. Tony Parker, you know what? You win three rings and you're the point guard. I'd say you're probably in the Hall of Fame. Well, guess what, Tony Parker? You might not be going to the Hall of Fame as a San Antonio Spur. That's right. Breaking news on the Davey Mac Sports program that I got from Google.
Pull up the sounder.
The Spurs are talking to multiple lottery teams about trading Tony Parker in exchange for a high first-round pick in the draft, which is to take place on Thursday. That's what league sources told Yahoo Sports. Tony Parker, goodbye. His life is falling apart faster than Tiki Barber's. First,
well,
Eva
Tiki's
Longoria.
Back together.
Yeah. First, Eva Longoria says goodbye to Tony Parker.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And now this. I mean,
you think he kills himself?
Well, I think that's a bit extreme there, Pepe. Right.
Sorry.
I don't know. That makes sense to me.
They're saying that the Spurs have talked to the Toronto Raptors, so talk about no man's land, or the Sacramento Kings, a team that's sort of, you know, it's not stable organization as the owners want to move the Kings out of Sacramento, possibly after next year. I don't know. I would be depressed. And I'll tell you this, as a Spurs fan, seems like Tony Parker has a good 3 or 4 years left in him. I'm not sure why you would want your starting point guard and a guy who's helped win you three rings to be off the team. I know they want to get younger, but, you know, you can get younger in other ways, can't you? A Russian soccer club accused of...
This just in.
Breaking news. Okay, babies? A Russian soccer club accused riot police of zapping one of its players with an electric shock as he tried to throw his shirt into the stands.
Aww.
Well, yeah.
Guy's trying to give a souvenir. The Ruskies come out and zap him to hell.
They don't mess around.
Comments.
Was he on ecstasy?
Actually.
Was the shirt on fire?
He was on ecstasy.
Oh, wow. It says it.
Yeah. Yeah. So there you have it.
What about the shirt? Fire?
Doesn't say.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's just give you one quick little thing here. Roger Clemens. Roger Clemens, him and his lawyers are trying to discredit the one of the accusers who says that Clemens did performance-enhancing drugs. Good. You might remember his name, Brian McNamee. That was the guy. He's like the star witness for the prosecution in the Roger Clemens case. And how are they trying to discredit McNamee? They're bringing up an incident where he was questioned by Florida police as a suspect in an October 2001 sexual assault.
Mm.
They say that McNamee, he was never charged, but they were suspicious that he had drugged an incoherent woman in a St. Petersburg hotel pool.
Damn.
And then raped her. And the rape drug GHB found in her system. I want to see you two jokers make some comments now.
Whoa.
That's what I thought! Jokers!
Looks like she had it coming.
Finally, all right, just play the music. Let's just get out of here before anyone just decides, before iTunes catches word of this debacle.
We didn't curse.
Finally, Pat Riley said, all's good. Eric Spoelstra, his little midget pal, will be coaching the Miami Heat next year.
Whoa, little person.
And I say this to Pat Riley. You're a slicked back, hair, bald-faced liar. That's what you are. Because I guarantee you, midway through the season, you see Riley again one last time doing those X's and O's. Take out the clipboard, Pat. We all know you want back in. Davey Mac Sports Program, Eastside Dave McDonald. Chris Peppa Stanley.
Hey!
Shauno.
Roy.
And I want to thank Pete, Doug, Rob, and others for contributing to the Davey Mac Sports Program. We appreciate everything you've given us. We were in some dire straits there, and they were very, very, very generous, and we cannot thank you guys enough. Also, check out Skinny Man. That's for all your audio needs.
Skinnyman.com.
EastsideDaveCountry.com. That's the website of joy. Twitter.com/EastsideDave. Enough with the plugs. Good night.